About the food. It is our joy. Not to accommodate. It is our joy to be, for him to be a part of us. And tonight, let us talk about, since he's not here, let's talk about him. Talk about him now. Okay, I'd like to call on first, perhaps the closest buddy that he has in our church is Ronnie, and maybe he is one of the last person that he spoke to. Ronnie spoke to Bob at Sunday morning around between 9 and 10. So I'm gonna call Ronnie Libramonte.
Last Wednesday, Pastor Alex called me and Pastor Nolly. So it did not sink in. So in my mind, he's still alive. And I had the same experience when my dad and my brother passed away. That I thought that they're just in the Philippines. I'm here and they're just in the Philippines. They're still alive. But with Bob, it's different. We've been good friends. Actually, we were prayer partners since like 5 years ago. We had a men's retreat, and I was partnered with him. So from then on, we've been good friends. We've been calling, we've been texting, and we talk a lot more when we move to Fontana. I'm driving from work 65 miles, so he knows this. So usually he will call me up between 6:30 to 7 o'clock. Because you know that this time I'm tired and I'm sleepy, so he will call me up. He will talk to me, talking about nonsense. Sometimes talking about the people he loves. Roby and the daughter, the youth. So he will. I'm always surprised with him because he will. I see him here whenever he attends church. I'm with him most of the time, and then when I talked to him the following Monday, he said, "Oh, I talked to this guy, and I talked a lot, and we had a long discussion." So I'm surprised how we did that, and I didn't even know. And there are even people who attended the church for the first time, and he was able to talk to him. So he's really a people person, and first thing that he will tell you is Jesus loves you. Amen. So it's always like Jesus loves you. And I remember, I think Pastor Alex will tell this story, but even in the hospital, his talk is always, the other person, not about him. No, it's always the people in the hospital, and he wants to save them. So So yes, so last time, last Wednesday, I called his phone, and for the first time, he did not answer. No? And then I left a message, and then Thursday night, he called me and said, no, I'm just in the, I have a doctor's appointment. So because it's not usual. Usually, if I call him and he's not available, he will call immediately. In the next 2 minutes, he will call back. But this time, he said he's in a he has a doctor's appointment. And so, but I talked to him Thursday, and he was not very happy, you know, especially Friday afternoon, he was very happy. Around noon Friday, he called a lot of us. You know. So, and unfortunately, some of those people that they called, because it's like around 1 o'clock, so they're working, so they never answered the phone, or most of them said, forget to call him back. No, but I thought, no, Friday he is really happy. Actually, we had a small celebration in my house Saturday, and he promised me he will be there. No, so he's been wanting to attend the church in the last 3-4 Sundays, but every time, you know, like Sunday morning, he always tells me he has a stomach flu. So every time he's not here, I'll text him, where are you? No, incidentally, I call him Kuya, so that's for older brother. No? So I will text him, where are you? He said that I have a stomach flu. But he's okay. You know? So Saturday he's happy, and he's really, you know, we've been talking about going to the Philippines, and he said I want to be a missionary. I'll stay in the Philippines for 6 months and find a girlfriend. No. I told him. At your age, you don't need a girlfriend, you need a wife. You need a wife now. And he said, I will line up people I know that, you know, that you can take care of you. No? And when he went to the hospital, the first time that he went to the hospital, he called me and said he's really in pain. And then I told him, how much is the pain? It's like 7. So I told him, okay, I'll get Jesse so he can bring you to the hospital. And I told him, but whatever, because I think week before that he went to the hospital and they released him. They told him to go home. So I told him, no, this time don't ever go. You need to stay in the hospital because you have that pain, no? And I told him, just tell the doctor that if something happens to me, you will be in charge. So anyway, so he went to the hospital, and during that time, actually, he really needed the operation, and you know, he did the operation, and I think it's more than a week. So he called me again and said, now I can go home. Okay, so because it's like around noon, I told him, okay, I'll ask my son to pick you up in the hospital and drive you to your house or your place, no? And then so I called my son, okay. I know it will be hard for him to eat or prepare his food. So I told my son, okay, buy some pork and beans, but can of pork and beans, Vienna sausage and bread and some lettuce, and I told him so he can eat this food without even cooking, no? And then when he was alone, he called me. What are you doing to me? You want to kill me? Because you know the Vienna sausage is all soft. No. I told him I choose that because those food you don't even need to cook. Most you can open it and then you can eat it. And plus, I have memories of pork and beans and Vienna sausage. So I told him the story, so he will try to eat those, because at first he doesn't want to eat them. You know, when I was in grade 5, grade 6, so we are poor in the Philippines. So the first time I was able to taste pork and beans is during camping. You know, we had camping, and one of my classmates brought the pork and beans and Vienna sausage. So now that I'm old, every time I eat pork and beans, I remember the time that we're going camping, you know? So I told him, so I want you to remember me. So just to so that he will give the food. And then, yeah, he was okay. So everything's running well, and then So I told him, you know, so you need to be strong. You need, you know, you need to go back to church because everybody is looking for you. And then, for some reason, he said that he needs to go back to the hospital. He needs another operation. And then, so everything's okay. So after he was released in the hospital, and after 3 weeks, he's already starting, at least going out. Whenever I call him in the afternoon, he said he's in Starbucks. And I think he started going to the gym. So, and then that's when he felt something's wrong with the operation. But for the most part, he's okay. He doesn't want you to worry about him. No? He will tell you, I'm okay. So when he said that, I'm really in pain, it's really in pain. But even during the time that he's in pain, he talked a lot about hopers. He's really a true-blooded hopers, and he knows everybody, maybe more than we've been here for a long time, but there are some people who came and I don't even know, but he has spent time with people, talking to people. So I talked to him Friday, then supposedly Saturday he will come in our house. So I text him the address, and then Saturday night he said he has a stomach flu again, and then Sunday around 9 o'clock, 9:30, he called me. Good thing that I answered the phone, and I talked to him and said, he's really in pain. So I told him, call me anytime. So if I need to go there and pick you up, and I'll bring you to the hospital. So he never called. So I thought everything is okay. And then Monday around 7 o'clock, I tried to call him, and for the first time, his phone is dead. So I said, this is unusual. I still thought that everything is okay. So anyway. As I said, when my dad passed away and my brother, it's okay for me because I didn't even shed a tear, because my thoughts is there alive there in the Philippines. But with Bob, I said it will be hard because he's calling me sometimes 5 o'clock in the morning, most of the time 7 o'clock, at least 2 to 3 times a week he called me. So that's why when I heard about the news the next morning, I want to call him. And I said, what if you answer the phone? So, it's not easy especially for us here, most of our relatives are in the Philippines, it's not easy to lose somebody who really affect your life. He is to me, he's really my brother, but sometimes I keep it, no, you're not my brother, you're my Lolo. So, and he, it's really hard. That's why when Pastor Nolan told me to, you will speak on Friday, and in the morning, I said, what will I say, And then I gather my thoughts, and I'm really crying. The whole day Thursday, I'm crying. That's why I was in my room and in the at work, and I really don't want to talk to anybody. And I told them I'm sick, so don't worry me. But I'm really crying the whole day. And I know Bob loves everybody. He can do it with people he doesn't know so much more with the people that really know. And he's proud of everybody. He's this person that. I remember during the time that he's in the hospital, Robbie called him, and he wanted me to talk to Robbie. He said, he's my son, talk to him. What will I talk to him? I don't know what to say, but he insisted on talking to him. He's proud. He's really proud. That's my memory of Bob. My Kuya Bob. He's my Kuya Bob. And, I'm thinking the first morning that he passed away, the next morning, the first day he was in heaven, he is in heaven, The first one is in heaven. So, Saint Peter, Peter did the roll call. You know, they're doing roll calls in heaven. So usually it's like, so he valid the arrangement. Sometimes he do a roll call by nationality. Sometimes the roll call is by gender. Sometimes by age. No, but this morning is really special. So Saint Peter did the roll call by church. So first thing he called. So when it start, when it's hope for the word turn. So he called hope for the word, and then Oscar Iniguez
present.
You be present. Yeah, something. And then he called Koy Ginto present. Then he called Bob Martin. Bob Martin. No, he's talking to the other. He's giving his testimony to the other. So Bob Martin. And thinking about Bob, I know. I'm sure he will dance, no? And he will do his marching. And he will say, Hallelujah, Jesus! And then he will say, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And then he will turn his face to Jesus. You love me. Something else, no? And I thank the Lord for, you know, for giving me a chance to be with him, especially in the last 2 years, no? So I really appreciate him, and yeah, thank you.
Amen. And he was in the hospital. He was lying down in bed, and then I was there. The nurse entered the room. Nurse, this is my pastor. Pastor, you talk to her. What should I say? And you know, that nurse is married to one of our members who used to come to this church. Oh, Bob. Okay. I guess we can call, we have, at least tonight, we were able to meet Bob's grown-up kids. And Cole, come first. Katie or Robin? So let's call on Katie, Bob's most favorite daughter.
When I was about 12. It was really cool. We didn't have much money, and so he traded a job for it. And I had it rebuilt, and I really wanted to play piano. And you know, he's incredibly musically talented. And so is Rob, who's like plays every single instrument up here. more so than I am. He got most of the talent. So I'd be sitting there playing the piano, come up behind me, and well, since we're telling the funny stories, so he'd gotten this sinus surgery, and as I saw that picture, I couldn't help but thinking of, I think I was maybe like 17, 18, playing the piano. He'd come up and he'd sit next to you, right? Like,
yeah, of course.
And he'd just gotten this sinus surgery. And so he would do this thing where he'd flush saline water through his sinuses. And he comes up like really, really sweetly. Puts his arm around and gives me a kiss, and all the water comes out. And he was so sweet. He was like, I was just going to kiss you. I'm so embarrassed. It's okay, Dad. It's okay.
That's sweet.
It was so cool. I love that you got like the martial arts moves. He's a lifelong, he boxed Golden Gloves in the Army. I could never, a few years ago, he was trying to help me with footwork, with the heavy bag in my garage. And finally he was like he's trying, he's like, yeah, it's okay. The jab is, it's a hard, I'm horrible. Rob's like a black belt. So, it didn't come down to me, and he was so sweet, and he was like, you know, as a kid, you were really fast. Like he was searching for like a really nice thing to say, and it was the nicest possible thing you could say in the circumstances. I didn't get it. But then he was hanging out with my son, his grandson, showing him how to. You know, kids pick on you at school, here's how you defend yourself. And he did. We called Grandpa Bob. He got my son gets suspended. Standing up for a smaller child, right? Because you know Bobby stands up for the underdog. And there's always fighting the good fight. And he gets suspended. And so we call Grandpa Bob. And he just immediately starts laughing and clapping over the phone. Yeah! That's my boy. So I took him out for pizza. With Grandpa Bob's blessing. He was so sweet. And then as my kids, all three kids got into martial arts, he visited the class and was like watching to make sure it was instructed correctly. Oh. It was so precious. And so just seeing these captured, it's just, I have such a flood of and memories from many different years. It's wonderful to be in a place where my dad is so loved. He loved you guys and talked about you all the time. Said the food was good. I'll give the mic to more people who have stories. But I just want to say this place is so full of love. And it's full of a lot of good memories. Mahal ki pa.
Top that. My dad really talked. He talked a lot about you guys. He really loved this church. He definitely wanted me to meet all of you, especially handing off the phone to everybody any chance he had. And he's like, oh yeah, this is so and so. I'm like, I have no idea. How are you doing? Like, it's like, dude, I got like 10 minutes. I can't talk to everybody right now. I think there's, I really got a lot of good things from my dad. In my store, everyone knows like where I am from hearing my laugh across the store. I've also gotten that I don't have much of an inside voice like my dad. He never really taught me to whisper. You couldn't really tell like secrets, because then everybody would know. I don't think he ever really. I don't think he ever like met a stranger. I'm pretty sure like everybody he met, he ended up being good friends with, and that was huge. And he was very charismatic, and he was good at. I guess I like always like making sure like I really felt welcome and loved and all that, and he liked to joke, and he liked to laugh all it. Yeah, he definitely liked to laugh at all his own jokes. He cracks himself up. A lot of my memories with my dad. I grew up just working with him doing construction. I'm not sure how much. I know he hasn't done a whole lot over the last 10 years, but I'm pretty sure he had me swinging a hammer before I could walk. I'm on the job site, but I think this whole life we have is our preparation for eternity, and I think there's like a lot of folks who do show up and do, and they just kind of like do the church thing. It's like, this is what we do on Sunday, and kind of it's like, it's a bad hobby, but one thing I know about my dad is my dad loved singing to Jesus, because yeah. I mean, like, that's what you're gonna do for eternity. Forget the golden streets and all this stuff. The focus is Jesus. There's no sun because he is the light. Mm-hmm. And I really do. He was ready. I remember even, before I moved out at night, and I'd hear him, in his bed, and just, praying to Jesus. He always had like worship music going. He's just continuing. This was his life preparing for eternity, and worshiping Jesus, So he'll just keep continue doing that. And that's where his heart was. So, yeah, that's...